Tonight, I'll just let you know that Rob is the, Rob Saik, he is the CEO of Agri-Trend Group of Companies. He's a professional agrologist and a certified agricultural consultant. As the founder of Agri-Trend, Robert has been involved in the development of technology, including the including the Agri Data Solution, which was the winner of Alberta's 2002 e-Business of the Year for on-farm data management. He has a whole host of accolades, and including having won, having Agri-Trend recognized as one of the 50 top best managed companies in Western Canada in 2014, and he was Agri-Trend was recognized in Venture Magazine as Alberta's 2013 top most innovative organizations. In 2006, Robert was recognized as a Distinguished Agrologist of the Year by Alberta Institute of Agrology. He was awarded the 2014 Canadian Agri-Marketer of the Year by the Canadian Association of Agricultural Marketers. And in July, he was appointed by the then Alberta Premier to Alberta Innovation Council. He's an author. One of his books is the Amazon 2014 Best of Books, The Agriculture Manifesto, and he is publisher of Ag Advance Journal, a 2014 Western Trade Journal of the Year. Rob has traveled extensively around the globe working on technology integration and agricultural advancements. And he is the executive producer of No GMO, a full feature movie project looking at the advancements of technology use in agriculture. So please help me welcome Rob.
Well, it is a real privilege to be with you at the University of Saskatchewan, to be in front of Les Henry, lecturing him. It's just great. And so many friends from the industry and farming community and students. And this talk I'm going to give today really could be entitled No Wheat or No Wheat. It really could be entitled No Seed Treatment or No Seed Treatment. It really could be entitled No Bacon or No Bacon. It could be entitled It could be entitled a variety of things. It could be entitled No Milk or No Milk. When it comes to agriculture, it could be entitled No Everything or No Everything. And it's impossible to know everything. And so through the course of the next hour and 15 minutes, because I'm going to show some footage today from the movie that we filmed around the world. You're the second audience to see it. And so I'm going to extend this a little bit longer than 45 minutes or an hour. So if you'll bear with me and let me do that, that'd be great. So now I'm trying to get the changer to work. Okay, this is good. All right. This is my world. This is literally and figuratively, this is my world. It's taken from an airplane, and that's my world. And it shows a picture of a flight between Winnipeg and Saskatoon on July the 21st, just before the Ag in Motion tour. I took it that day. What are some of the things that you see in this picture? Well, you see vast land in this picture, vast landscape. You see vast fields of canola that are blooming. And you don't see any people. There's no people. There's, call it 90 million acres of farmland like this in Western Canada. There's no people out there. So I ask you a question. How does all of this get done? How does a crop get slammed in the ground in 25 or 15 days? Technology. That's how. This picture, I've got the same picture from Argentina. I've got the same picture from Kazakhstan or Russia or Ukraine. Vast tracts of land, no people, and yet the work gets done. How can I speak of this? Well, I speak of this because I have an organization, a powerful organization that we built from the ground up called Agri-Trend. And we have about 250 people now that are pan-North American, from Lacrete, Alberta, down to Mississippi and Texas, and from Vancouver Island all the way across to Gatineau, and then across the Pacific Northwest through the Corn Belt, all the way to Delaware and Pennsylvania. We've got about 250 people. that don't sell fertilizer and chemical, don't sell seed, and don't buy grain. We coach farmers in terms of what's happening in terms of technology integration on the farm. We work in three different areas. We provide farmers coaching, provide them data services, and we provide them knowledge, in other words, scientific underpinning for what's going on the coaching and the data side with farmers. So our agri-coaches provide leadership to farmers in the area of production, marketing, and business. Grow the crop, sell the crop, manage the money. And all those areas have idiosyncrasies and professional competence that's required to make it all work. Agri-knowledge, and we have some of our agri-knowledge guys here today. Jim's here. These guys are masters and PhDs. They are senior coaches with Agri-Trend. They are scientific disciplinary experts, and they provide scientific support to our coaches and to our data platform. Our data platform was 2002 eBusiness of the Year and 2015 Ag Innovation Award winner. We're just going to win that award next week in Red Deer. It's managing your whole farm in your hand. It is about massive amounts of data. We provide the data services for the potatoes that go into McDonald's French fries through Simplot and now Cavendish. So we happen to know a little bit about agriculture. So when I'm standing up in front of you here today, I don't come to you as a novice. I come to you as somebody who's deeply experienced and deeply passionate about agriculture. But I do that against a backdrop of the technology that we're all faced with in agriculture today. On the screen, you see a picture of a guy named Peter Diamandis. Him and I were born the same day. Peter is the founder of the XPRIZE Foundation, the $10 million sponsor of the shot to space and back, and now the $10 million Qualcomm Prize. They're working right now on $10 million. There's 10 teams left in the competition to turn your smartphone into a device where you could spin on it or pee on it or bleed on it, and it would provide a diagnosis to you, and there's 10 teams left, and they're going to crack this. It's going to change medicine. This is Peter Diamandis. This is one of my inspiration guys that I go to. It's one of the reasons that we founded the Canola Agri-Prize, the Canola 100 that Agri-Trend just sponsored. We believe in that. And there's a lot that I've learned from Peter in terms of genomics and biotech and all sorts of technology and scientific integration. And I'm wearing this tie. This tie is a double helix. It's a DNA tie. And I kind of thought it was kind of cool to wear for this lecture. So, but I don't like ties that much, so I'm just going to take it off and loosen up for a second. If you'll let me, that'd be great. All right. I'll drape it just so it has there. A little bit of marketing there. That's why I got the marketing award. And I'm gonna paint a picture. I'm gonna take you really big, first of all, and then I'm gonna talk to you about technology currents. I'm gonna distill all that down and tell you why agriculture is changing so fast, and then try to share with you some of the disconnects that are going on between urban and rural people. So this was the year I was born, 1960. Yeah, I know, do the math, I'm 55. Okay, so 1960 was the year I was born, and there's more of us in Canada than anybody else. It was the most reproductive year in Canadian history, was due to 1960. In 1960, the year I was born, this represents the number of people who died under the age of 50 in 1960. These are the number of people who died under the age of 50. The red dot represents China, and the blue dot represents India. These were the number of people who made less than $4,000 per annum per year. These are the people who lived above 70, and these are the people who made more than $10,000 a year. This was the year I was born, 55 years ago. Flash forward to 2013. I know I should have 2015, but this is from Gapminder with Hans Rosling, the Swedish statistician, gapminder.com. It's excellent. All the stats are there. I'm not making this shit up. It's just real. So this is the number of people dying under the age of 50 in 2013. These are the number of people making less than $4,000 a year, primarily in Africa. You'll notice that China has shifted way up to the top right-hand corner. You know that India has shifted up. You'll notice the number of people living above 70 is way more than it was in 1960. And you'll notice they had to extend the chart to 85. So do you want to live in this world? Is this the world you want to live in today, the good old days, or do you want to live here? I choose to live here. Do you want to live like here or here? Here or here? What? Like, choose. Choose. So are more people dying of cancer today? Well, of course they are. They're living longer. And if you get cancer today, you've got a 62% chance of beating it versus about 26 or 29% back in 1960. Things are changing. The problem is most people don't think. We're just floating down a river, just drinking beer. Most people don't think. Most people don't think about the currents I'm about to share with you. The currents in which all of us are being pulled along, not just agriculture. All of us are being pulled by powerful currents. And when you're in a river drinking beer, you really never know how fast you're moving until you look at the shore. You go, holy crap, really going pretty quick here. It's four reactions. One is, you can jump out of the tube and swim against the current. Some people do that, not all that smart. Second reaction, you can jump out of the tube and try to swim to the shore. Near the shore, that's where all the turbulence is. Maybe not such a smart idea either. A lot of people do that. Some people in the room here will notice the current, jump out of the tube and swim in the direction of the current, try to get there first. Maybe I'm talking to some tonight. The vast majority of people don't think. They just take another sip of the beer and keep floating down a river. Isn't this cool? Powerful currents that are underpinning our lives today. This is a great slide. This is a picture of internet traffic around the world. You'll notice from Hawaii, all of the internet traffic beaming back to North America. That is Saskatchewan farmers enjoying Hawaii on vacation. That is Saskatchewan farmers using their iPhone apps to check if their grain bins are heating. Seriously, if you don't understand what I just said there, that's pretty profound. The thing is, we live in an exponential world today. I grew up in a town of 450 people, well, 449 because I left. But my graduating class was 18, 9 girls, 9 boys. We hardly thought outside the county of Minburn. We didn't think about that. My first rock and roll concert, embarrassingly enough, was the Bay City Rollers when I was 16. I never had a McDonald's burger till I was 16. Some of you think that's good. I like McDonald's. But anyways, the reality is we lived in a very, very small world, a linear world. If you got up in the morning, had a coffee, and walked down your driveway and took 30 paces, you'd go 30 paces. But today we live in an exponential world where the first pace is one pace, and the second pace is two paces, the third pace is four, the fourth pace is eight. And by the time you take a 30 exponential paces, you've gone a billion yards or billion meters and circled the globe 26 times. That's the world you young people live in today. That's the world of exponential change. That's the world agriculture lives in today. And data. It's been estimated since the dawn of mankind in 2003, we produced 5 exabytes of written data. Today, we produce 5 exabytes of written data every 2 weeks, if not every 15 minutes. Every farmer in the room here today has got that pile of Western Seducer, Grown News, Top Crop Manager, and hopefully Ag Advanced Journal that he's going to go home and read, and you'll never keep up because the amount of data is just exploding exponentially. It's a challenge for agriculture to keep up to the amount of data that's hitting us right now. The amount of data that's available to a farmer on a smartphone is just amazing. It just obliterates what we had in the past. And growing up on the farm in Innisfree, Alberta, ideas had sex. I want to build a go-kart. I got a Briggs & Stratton. Most of you wouldn't know what that is. So anyway, I got a Briggs & Stratton, and I want to put some wheels on it. I would talk to a buddy, and we weld it together. These ideas would have sex. Well, today, ideas have orgies. You have an idea in North America. It goes to China, and it gets refined. It can be manufactured and sold in Europe in sometime the same week. That's the speed of change. That's the current. What's causing this? Well, computing power is causing this. Right now, a computer calculates at about 10 to the 9th, 10 to the 10th calculations per second. By 2025, a computer, $1,000 computer, can you hear that? Can you guys hear that in my head? That's my phone ringing in my head right now. You want to talk about technology? I can't fix, just a second. Sorry. I have hearing aids. You guys don't know that. And the hearing aids are connected by Bluetooth to my phone. So when I go down the street, I just talk into the thin air, and it talks into the phone. Kind of weird, eh? Technology. Weird, huh? Just like a cyborg. Anyways, by 2023, a $1,000 laptop will be calculating at 10 to the 16th power. What's significant about that? $1,000 laptop calculating the same speed as your human brain. For Ukrainians, it's a little bit slower, but that's okay. You know, I'm Ukrainian, I gotta get away with it. By 2050, a $1,000 laptop will be calculating at 10 to the 26th power. A $1,000 laptop calculating the same speed as the entire human race. This is your life. This is your world. You will live through all of this if you're a young person in the room. You will see all of this. In 60 seconds right now, 120 hours is loaded up every 60 seconds into YouTube. 50 billion WhatsApp messages go out every 60 seconds. You didn't know WhatsApp is. I don't know. How many guys have WhatsApp? All right. Good. That's pretty good. I didn't know what it was until I got to Argentina, and then I'm dealing with WhatsApp. 3.3 million Facebook posts, 4 million Google searches every 60 seconds. 98% of the pictures ever taken in human history will be taken this year. A lot of people live in a world of scarcity. Are you a Malthusian or are you a cornucopian? Do you believe the world's getting worse or do you believe the world's getting better? That defines that. Not too long ago, a speaker was in front of 1,200 teachers in Chicago, and he asked the teachers, how many of you think the world's getting worse every year? And they all put up their hands. And he says, that's what you're teaching our kids. I don't live in that world. I live in a world of abundance. Some of you may think it's a world of delusion. I don't think so. I think that every problem we've tackled, we've wrapped our heads around it and made it work. And I think if we put our minds to it, we can make it work. But when you think about where the information comes from today in breakneck speed onto your smartphone devices, mostly coming from the media, and it's mostly negative news. And if you were in the media today, it's a negative world because that's a bureaucratic world that's being completely dematerialized by things like Twitter. And the healthcare industry is being dematerialized and the education system is being dematerialized. I wouldn't want to be managing the budget of a university right now. Tough place. So my question, my thread that I'm going to put through this lecture is, will agriculture lose science to non-science? And you could substitute the word nonsense in many cases there. That's my question. The problem is, people have a romanticized view of agriculture that doesn't exist anymore. It's not 1960 anymore. And unfortunately, most people are one or two or even three generations removed from the farm. In North America today, farmers are about 1.5% of the population. 97% of farms still are family farmed, although they may be incorporated. They're family farm, big business, and they're run on a high-tech game. September 24th, I was asked to speak to the Canadian Farm Writers Federation in Calgary. I was asked to come and be on a panel. The topic was bridging the urban-rural divide. And I got up in front of them and I said, I know a lot of work goes into a conference. I know I'm going to hurt somebody's feeling, but the problem is represented on your logo. Everybody understands the skyscrapers, but the little red barn is absolutely asinine. The little red barn hasn't existed on farms for 30 to 50 years, unless you use it to store shit or as a tourist thing. We don't use little red barns anymore. And whoever sold the silos, these harvest store salesmen, were brilliant salespeople, but they're not in use anymore. And here we are with the Canadian farm writers who are supposed to be talking about the image of agriculture to the urban people, wondering why there's a divide. Jeez, do you think? You know, you wrap that up with a round fender stepside 1950 pickup truck and put a guy in bib overalls and you got the quintessential image of an urban person who what he thinks about farming. And it's all wrong. There's a need for technology. This was then. Or that was then. And I did this, actually. And when you do this, your dad kicks your ass all around the farm. And this is now. This is a friend of ours, an Agri-Trend person, Terry Eberhardt. He farms 11,000 acres up in Langenberg. Last September, in the middle of harvest, I asked Terry to come to Sylvan Lake for a meeting. And he left his harvest and he came to Sylvan Lake, Alberta, for a meeting. And after the meeting, we went out on the water. And we're on the water after the meeting, in the middle of his harvest, drinking beer, watching his wife combine on his iPhone. It's a perfect world. Look at that. For those of you who haven't farmed, we're watching her farm, we're watching her harvest in real time on his iPhone. It's like we're in the cab of the combine, right? So I wrote a book. I wrote a book called The Agriculture Manifesto. And you guys have been given a card. This is a response card. If you give me some feedback, you can say I'm full of shit, doesn't matter, I don't care. But you give me some feedback, and you'll get a book. And the deal is, if you get a book, you get to read it. It's only 55 pages. Sorry, Jimmy, no pictures. But anyways, 55 pages. And I want you to pass it along. The deal is, you take the book, you pass it along, okay? I just want people to understand farming better. That's what I want to happen. There's 10 points, but there's one point I'm going to dwell on today, which is point number one, which is the non-science movement. And again, will agriculture lose significant science to non-science? That's my concern. I believe today, as I stand in front of you right now, I sincerely believe that the non-science movement is the greatest threat to global food security on the planet today. You want to have anarchy? Take away an ability of a family to feed its children. That's anarchy, and it happens quicker than you think. We need to begin shouting out of the darkness. And my shouting out of the darkness began, I guess, a couple of springs ago. Maybe, was it last spring? I can't even remember now. I gave this speech in Winnipeg, Manitoba at Grain World. Then I gave it at the Brandon Chamber of Commerce on Tuesday. I was on the road all week, flew back to Red Deer, gave this speech at Westerner Park in Red Deer. And Joel Ward, who's president of Red Deer College, was there, and he said, what are you doing tonight, Rob? And I said, I don't know, I'm pretty tired. He says, well, do you want to go to the Chilliwack concert? And I said, I love Chilliwack. It's so cool. He says, well, here's a VIP pass. Now, I have to confess that I had a couple glasses of wine before the concert. Fair enough, right? But I get into the concert, and there's 650 people at the Red Deer College Auditorium. The lights go out. I start tweeting, I'm at the Chilliwack concert, and I love Chilliwack. California girl, California girl. And I'm just tweeting away, and then about a third of the way through the concert, they stop the concert, and the lead singer, Bill Henderson, starts to say, well, the next song is about the patenting of life. The next song is about poison blowing in the wind. And I kind of sit up, and he said, the next song is about an organic canola farmer in Saskatchewan, just trying to grow organic canola. And I said to the guy, I can't believe I'm hearing this. And he says, of course, this organic canola farmer is just trying to grow canola, and he got sued by Monsanto. And of course, Monsanto won. And this is all about poison blowing in the wind and the patenting of life. And I shouted out of the darkness, you're wrong. And I stopped the Chilliwack concert. And he goes, what? And I said, I know the facts in this case, and what you're telling the audience is wrong. And he said, he says, I have the mic. I said, doesn't mean you're right. And we got into this thing for about 45 seconds. I finally got up. I was shaking, and I left. It was wild. I was so mad. And I got out that night, and I wrote a letter of apology to the president of the Red Deer College and the mayor of the city of Red Deer and the mayor of the county of Red Deer, who was a farmer and in the audience, and then a letter of apology to the MP, who was a farmer and in the audience. But as soon as I left that room, my phone lit up with farmers in the audience saying, thanks for standing up for us, Rob. Then I wrote a letter to the editor the next day. It says, yesterday at the Chilliwack concert in Red Deer, there was a bit of a commotion. I know, because I caused it. And here's why. It was my shout out of the darkness. And that's what began what you're hearing about today. It was my shout out of the darkness. So we need to stand up and shout out of the darkness. We need to talk about what's going on our farms. We need to explain what our chemistry is about. We need to explain what technology is about. That's my shout of the darkness. We have a problem right now. Because it doesn't matter if you have expert opinion, case studies, controlled case studies, cohort studies, randomized, systematic, or metadata studies, it is all trumped by, I just know. What do you know? Well, I just know. I read it on the internet. It's just awful. Really? You just know. How much do you know? Well, I just know. Who has the answers? Who's in the driver's seat? Is Joe, I didn't know you guys were interviewing Joe. It's perfect, actually. Is Joe Schwartz, a distinguished professor of chemistry from the University of McGill, is he in the driver's seat? Or is a 16-year-old Rachel Parent in the driver's seat, whose parents, by the way, have organic businesses? Who is in the driver's seat? Who has more Twitter followers? Well, I'll guarantee you she does. Who speaks soundly of science mind? I'll guarantee you he does. But who's in the driver's seat? See, we have all kinds of food trends and food experts. We got detox diet, Mexican diets, organic diets, paleo diets, gluten-free diets, fermented food diets, home diets, all kinds of food trends by so-called food experts all over the planet. Food Babe gets on her site and says, canola oil is bad. And while you're at it, just wipe out all oils from your pantry and do it now. They're killing you. She has hundreds of thousands of followers. And by the way, buy the coconut oil that I'm selling. And somehow that's okay, right? Somehow that's okay. Less than a year ago, January 16th in the U.S., they did a survey. 82% of Americans, and I probably think Canadians too, say that GMO foods should be labeled. Same survey said that 80.44% of people believe that food containing DNA should be labeled. Is it right or wrong? Do we know what we're talking about? Do we really know? Last year, last summer, the Western producer, together with Myers, Norse, and Penny, did a survey of over 500 farmers in Western Canada. You in the room responded to it. And they asked, what is keeping farmers awake at night? And you responded as farmers, commodity prices, weather, and farm input prices. Well, duh. You didn't have to take a survey for me to tell you that. But this is where you as farmers ranked consumer pressure, way over here. It's a non-issue. Didn't come up on your radar screen. And yet consumer pressure is a freight train coming down the track ready to T-bone you at the intersection. And for most people in agriculture, we aren't even aware that consumer pressure even exists. Last October, September and October, Jason Luss ran a study about what consumers are worried about for their health from food. What are they worried about? Number one, salmonella, fair dinkum. Number two, E. coli. That's important. Number three, GMO. Really? Name me one person who's been harmed. Name me one. Hormones. Really? Hormones are hurting. Hormones rated above swine flu. And swine flu is serious. If you get it, you're going to be sick for weeks and weeks and weeks. I mean, it's serious. Seriously. These are the things that are on the consumer's mind. These are the things that are on the consumer's brain. Can't shut it off. It's there. It's real. Last spring, I go to a marketing course, and I go to a marketing course down in Phoenix, Arizona, and one of the guys there is a documentarian. His name is Jeff Hayes, and he's produced a movie called Bought. Bought is an anti-vaccination movie and an anti-GMO movie. And I said to him, I said, you know what, Jeff? I said, you really need to report both sides of the story. And so he said, well, do you want to be on the movie? And I said, sure. So on the May long weekend, I flew myself down to Cedar Rapids, Iowa, where the film crew was, put myself on camera, signed my life away, 2 hours on camera, appeared at 0 minutes in the movie. 0 minutes. We have to tell the other side of the story. So I started this last November with a TEDx talk. I've been fortunate enough to travel to Uganda, Kenya, and now Nigeria. I was just in Nigeria about a month ago. This is a picture of me I did a soil survey over Kenya. I did 10 different areas. I took soil samples, and this is in the Maasai Mara. A warrior was helping me clean out my soil probe. And I did a TEDx talk. And my TEDx talk was really centered around this woman. This woman was filmed, this picture was taken up at Lodwar, Kenya, northeastern Kenya, one of the poorest parts of Kenya, one of the poorest places I've ever been on the planet. She hadn't eaten that day yet, and it was afternoon. There was food coming, apparently. But this was a picture of her and her child. And in her hand, she's got a smartphone, and Kenya's got excellent communication technology. And as I look at this picture, I wonder who would be so cruel as to walk up to her and rip that smartphone technology out of her hand and take it away from her. Because with that smartphone, she can text and find out where water is. She can find out text which way food is. She can communicate to the world. But yet, if you think about agriculture, people who have no understanding of agriculture want to go and rip technology out of agriculture's hands. They want to take that technology away from agriculture. Who would be so cruel as to do that unknowingly? So when I get asked whether agriculture can feed 9 billion people, I say, absolutely. I'm totally confident we can do that. My question is, will we be allowed to feed 9 billion people? That's the question that I have. I want to introduce you to some people. This is Robert. He's from Gulu, Uganda, cassava farmer. This is Eric from Kericho in Kenya. Samuel is from Kampala, and this is a famous picture of a beautiful young girl who's gone blind to vitamin A deficiency. What do these people all have in common? Well, they all have in common that they could be helped with technology that sits today on the shelf, proven technology that's being withheld from them. That's what they have in common. I think this will go down as one of the travesties in humanity. The withholding of golden rice, half a cup a day, would solve. These people eat rice. I see all the time on the internet, well, give them supplements or give them broccoli. They don't eat broccoli. They eat rice. That's what they have. And every year, hundreds of thousands of kids go blind, and every year, hundreds of thousands of people die, and millions have died since 2002 while this product is withheld by activist groups such as Greenpeace that campaign against this release. I think this is a travesty against humanity. Cassava. You guys never had it? Tapioca pudding. Cassava gets attacked by brown streak mosaic. They dig it up to eat it. It rendered itself useless because the mosaic virus has attacked the cassava. You're going to see this later on in the film. This is black sigatoga and bacterial wilt in bananas. In Uganda, they're cutting down the banana trees and importing bananas from other areas where they should be growing it themselves. And there is no cure. There's no cure for the brown streak mosaic and cassava. There's no cure for the black sigatoga and bacterial wilt in bananas. And in Kenya right now, there's a runaway rampant problem right now with lethal necrosis in maize. And everywhere you looked, as far as I could see, the maize was rendered useless with aflatoxin and mycotoxin. And you say, well, it's not my problem. I don't know those people. I don't even know those crops. I don't really care. Well, do you like orange juice? Because if you like orange juice, you should care. Because this year's citrus crop in Florida is 20% less than last year's because of citrus greening. And it was 20% less than the year before. The citrus industry in Florida is done. And there's no cure. Spray all the insecticides you want. You can't knock out the psyllus fly. That's why when you go down to Florida right now, you see netting all around the trees because they can't cure it. And now it's spread to California. So what is your answer? How do you fix it? Cut down the groves? Well, they're doing that already. Replant? Comes back. How are we going to fix this? Well, spray insecticides. Well, I thought you didn't want insecticides. What are we going to do? We will need agricultural technology, including genetic engineering, if we're going to maintain global food security. It's how we're going to do it. And yet, fanaticism is causing, in my mind, global suffering. And it's built around fear, paranoia, and genetic engineering could be a threat and donate here. Greenpeace sits on, last time I heard, over $500 million worth of cash. You don't raise cash unless you've got a campaign to be fearful against. In The Economist magazine in 2013, they said, I want you right now to imagine a child under the age of five, your niece, nephew, son, daughter, just imagine grandchildren, somebody under the age of five. In 2013, the number of kids who died from malnutrition under the age of five was 3.1 million children, gone, dead from this planet. The number of children who died from GMO, zero, ever. And yet it seems the less money we spend on food, the more time we have to complain and bitch about food. In Canada, we spend about 3.9% of our disposable income on food. By February 4th, the average Canadian has made enough money to pay for food for the year. The rest of the time, we just complain about it. In Kenya, they spend 45% of their disposable income on food. They want food. They want to be fed. I believe that a lot of what we're dealing with is food paranoia as a first world problem. If you go to Google Images and you put in the word GMO, this is what you see. First of all, most of these crops or vegetables aren't GMOs, but they certainly all appear to be sick. Maybe they're diabetic. And right now, if you know somebody who's injecting insulin, Humalog or Novalin, they're being kept alive with GMO technology. That's a GMO. But there are people out there angry against GMOs. What is it that they're protesting against? Hemophiliacs? Down with hemophiliacs! Because they're also being kept alive with GMO technology. Or maybe it's down with hard cheese. 90% of the cheese in North America is GMO'd. They use rennet to get chismosin. Chismosin is a coagulant. We used to get it by scraping the fourth stomach of a calf lining. We used to get that enzyme there. Or by scraping camel's stomachs. Now we don't. We use a GMO technology for about 90%. Not all of it. These people are mad. They're teaching their children to be mad against GMOs. Down with Monsanto. Are you against GMOs or just against Monsanto? Monsanto is a big company. Monsanto is a $15.8 billion corporation. Monsanto speaks positively about GMOs to their customers, and their customers are farmers, representing about 1% of the population. Whole Foods, $14.2 billion company, and they speak negatively about GMO to their customers. And their customers are the other 98% of consumers out there. Whole Foods has 4.6 million followers on Twitter. Monsanto has an astounding 69,000. So when I think about this and I get accused of shilling, I say, really? Who's shilling for who here? I'm wondering. Took this picture down in Maricopa, Arizona. What's the difference between these peppers? Well, 30 feet and $250,000. Because if you feed your family this organic basket, this pepper is 65% more than this pepper. If you buy into that and you feed your family that basket of goods, by the time you get a family of four through to high school, you'll spend about $250,000 more on food. It's fine. But because you can afford to spend 30 to 300% more on food, does that give you the right to condemn those who can't? Apparently it does. The millionaires, fashion millionaires, just a year ago, presented an anti-GMO petition to the UK Parliament, and on the way out, she was asked by a reporter, what are poor people supposed to do, can't afford organic food? And she said, quote unquote, they should eat less. The anti-science movement is the greatest threat to global food security today. The voices of science are being drowned out by the voices of fear and paranoia. And I would go so far as to say first world activism, certainly, and I would call it elitism, is hurting the poorest people on the planet, the people that we don't even know, haven't even met, and are unlikely to meet. We're going to need all kinds of science, including GMO, if we're going to feed 9 billion plus people. And we should celebrate agricultural successes. We should celebrate organic farming. There's a lot that we can learn as farmers from organic farmers. There's a lot about microorganisms and bioflora, microflora. There's a lot that we can learn if we embrace those ideas. And if you want to buy that, be privileged to buy that. Just don't ram it down my throat. We should celebrate local food production. We should celebrate farmers' markets, the fact that you can connect with food growers. And if you really want to celebrate food, grow your own food. Grow your own food, and you'll appreciate fungicide a hell of a lot more than you ever did before. We should celebrate fertilizer. One of the greatest inventions in mankind is The Haber-Bosch process that turns that 78% inert nitrogen into fertilizer. And it's estimated that 50% of the protein of every human being on the planet today owes itself to fertilizer. And we should celebrate that. Is it perfect? It's not perfect. There's lots of things we could do better. It's pretty good. We should celebrate pesticides. If you took pesticides away from farmers today across the planet, food production would drop an estimated 42%. Celebrate pesticides. Celebrate the fact that what we're doing today, how many guys were farming in the 70s in this room here? Yeah. Well, you want to go back? Huh? You want to go back? No. We're putting on a lot. We are so specific today, down to grams per acre. It's amazing. And we should celebrate genetic engineering. The fact that we can harness those massive currents to do a job better. And I have a question for you. Could the future of food be GMO? And what I mean by that is, could the future of food be genetically modified organic food production? There's not a farmer in the room here today that jumps up out of the bed, delighted at jumping in his sprayer, $500,000 sprayer, and spraying on insecticide at $25 an acre. There's not a farmer in the room excited about so-called dousing his crops with chemicals. That's bullshit. There's not a farmer today that gets excited about spending and stroking a $150 or $250 per acre check on fertilizer. The organic movement started by trying to reduce dependency on synthetic fertilizers and synthetic pesticides. And I don't think that's a bad thing. And in my mind, as an agronomist and as an agrologist, the only thing I see on the horizon that could do that is genetic engineering. Genetic engineering would allow us to reduce our pesticide use, and it has. Genetic engineering would allow us to extract more nutrients from the soil, and it could. So when did the organic movement become the anti-GMO movement, and why? That's really a really good question. And you have to follow the money. It's big money. I mean, when you can go into a grocery store, you can charge people more money on fear-based mentality, there's a lot of cash there. Organically powdered sugar. It's sugar. The molecular structure is sugar. It's sugar. Do an analysis. It's sugar. Organic water. Non-GMO Himalayan rock salt. It's rock salt from the Himalayas. I challenge these guys, and they say, oh, we use non-GMO corn starch to stop the anti-caking. Really? Yeah. For the ladies in the audience, or maybe guys these days too, I don't know, but you got cosmetics, you got non-animal testing, non-corn, non-GMO, organic, gluten-free cosmetics. As I kiss my girlfriend, it should be gluten-free. So much spin out there. This is Whole Foods selling water, 16 ounces of water for $6, that's American, with a couple of asparagus sprigs in it. This was in Calgary. This is label spin at its finest. $97.04 for beef. $97 a kilogram for beef. Well, it is, you know, raised without antibiotics, no grass, and probably cageless. Which is what I saw at Whole Foods in New York City. Label spin. You think buying something that's non-GMO is going to make a difference to your health? Do you really think? Do you think natural is better for you? What is natural? And what is organic? And label spin. This was taken in Whole Foods, New York City. Organic, gluten-free, non-GMO, kosher, non-baked, non-fried, vegan, and only $7.99 for 3 ounces. I don't know what the hell is in it, but it's expensive. I don't know how it would sustain you for life. I'm not sure. We laugh about these things, but it's not funny. Today's consumer is sophisticated. He or she is educated, spend a lot of time, and they care about what they feed their families. And they want to buy what's good for their families. And they want to buy organic because they want to avoid chemicals. Back to Kenya. This is a picture of chrysanthemums in Kenya. Do you know what they're harvesting chrysanthemums for? Pyrethrin. Do you know what pyrethrin is? Pyrethrin is an organic insecticide right there. Oh my God, what do you mean organic insecticide? Well, Bacillus thuringiensis is an organic insecticide. The greens all represent organic pesticides. What do you mean, pesticides? Of course you have to use pesticides. They got bugs and problems. This is Roundup, and the further down you go, the more poisonous it is, okay? This is the chart. This is an LD50 chart. And right below it is Bacillus thuringiensis. Bacillus thuringiensis is a bacteria that you spray on crops, on organic crops. They use it all the time, spray it multiple times to control Lepidoptera. They control the caterpillars and the bugs that come into organic crops. It's the same ingredient that you splice into corn, soybean, and cotton to fight Lepidoptera. It's a GMO. Now, there's some of you went out, some of you students went out last night, you drank too much, right? So you drank too much last night, which is only slightly less toxic than Roundup, by the way. I should put alcohol on this chart. And you got up in the morning and you pounded some aspirin because you had a hangover. And you went outside, had a smoke. Then you came inside, had a coffee. And then you put a bunch of salt on your eggs and ate some bacon. And all that is more toxic than Roundup. And we don't know that. People say, I want organic because it's not genetically modified. Well, I got news for you. Everything's genetically modified. Your dogs, cats, horses, cows, pigs, chickens, everything that we have is genetically modified in one way or another. Our bodies are genetically modified. That's why we can't eat foods in other areas, because we're genetically modified for this area, not that area, because of bacteria and the microbes in our bodies. Carrots weren't orange. Carrots were originally white or purple. Through a freak of nature, they had some orange carrots, and wonderfully enough, they appeared in Dutch, in Holland, and orange was the color of royalty in the Dutch, and the Dutch loved it, and it kind of took off, and that's why we have carrots today. So what is this whole thing about GMO? Because you notice I didn't actually say the word yet. I've just been using the acronym, which most of you would. It's a meaningless acronym, absolutely meaningless. Because it really is defining breeding processes. It's defining modern breeding processes. Well, I don't want modern breeding processes. I prefer natural breeding processes. Okay. Conventional breeding, cross-pollinization, or hybridization takes years to achieve the beneficial trait. Thousands of genes are affected. You don't actually know how many. No safety testing, no long-term studies, and you can bring it to the marketplace. But it's natural. Well, sure it is. But it's slow. So we'll speed up the process. We'll speed up the process by exposing our seeds to gamma rays, nuclear radiation, or subjecting them to carcinogenic chemicals in a process known as mutagenesis. So you achieve the desired trait faster. You don't believe they do this. This is how they do it. They have a gamma ray rod. They put the seeds beside the rod for 1 hour, 10 hours, 20 hours. They take the seeds, they plant them. Most seeds go like that. But occasionally you get a trait that's really beneficial, like the ruby red grapefruit. The ruby red grapefruit is derived from mutagenesis. So is Clearfield canola, for those guys who are in the audience. There's no knowing how many genes are affected. No telling. You don't know. There's no safety testing, no long-term studies, and over 2,400 organic crops owe their origin to mutagenesis. And somehow that's okay. Now we cross into the world of genetic engineering, and I've only got a couple examples. RNAi technology, the ability to switch off certain genes in plants, usually one to two genes that are silenced. An example of that is Arctic apples, where they have silenced the polyphenolic oxidase enzyme, preventing the apples from browning prematurely. It slows down the browning process. It's excellent. It's from the apple. They switched off the genes. It stops the browning. Stops bruising, stops browning. Hundreds of thousands of tons of wastage of apples every year. And this is heavily tested and has to be registered and goes through extensive processes. It's bad. And then transgenics, the insertion of a couple of genes from a donor into a host plant, site-specific, usually one to four genes, extensive safety testing required. BT cotton, corn, soybeans are an example of that. And I could go into CRISPR technology and gene editing technology and a whole bunch, and people say GMO is bad. What the hell are we talking about here? Are you talking about RNAi technology? Is that bad? Or is it mutagenesis? Is that bad? Or is it, you know, is it transgenics or cisgenics? Like, what's bad? Plant breeding has advanced more in the last 5 years than the previous 5,000 years. And we're not supposed to take advantage of that. Genetic engineering is an advancement of that breeding process. And the biggest thing about this is GMO isn't an ingredient. People say label GMOs. I say label what? What is it that you want to label? Tell me exactly what it is that you want to label. Do you want to label transgenics? Fair enough. Cisgenics? Fair enough. But if you want to label one breeding process, you got to label them all. Call fair is fair, spade is spade. And it doesn't matter how many National Academy of Sciences, Royal Science of Medicine, European Commission, National Council of Sciences, doesn't matter how many of years, how many of thousands of tests, hundreds of research paper, it's all trumped by, I just know. That's our problem. What do we know? What do you know about GMO? What is one of the first and most successful GMO crops ever commercialized? No?
Papaya.
Papaya was. Did you guess papaya? The ring spot virus was decimating the papaya crop in Hawaii, and it was Dr. Gonzalez, who you'll see, and a group from Cornell University that saved the Hawaiian papaya crop. And now they want to cut down all the papayas in Hawaii and go back to organic, which means the disease will come back in, and you'll see that too. In our world, canola, because that was brought up, HT canola stats, primarily GMO canola stats, have resulted in a 53% reduction in herbicide use. I know that because I used to sell that stuff. 55% reduction in producer exposure. 1.3 kilogram reduction in active ingredient. Environmental impact quotient is way down. Yields are up. Soil erosion is down 66%. Greenhouse gases is down 26%. $19 billion to the Canadian economy. And somehow, this is bad. Some stats for you, for status people. This is land based in Ontario, and there's an update coming on this. This is the land based to corn in Ontario. This is the yield of corn in Ontario since GMOs have come in, 92 to 156, 69% increase. And this is the utilization of herbicides, all herbicides in Ontario, including glyphosate Roundup. Okay? This one's better. This is from the United States. This is the impact on reduction of organophosphates and carbamates by BT corn. And those things were nasty. Turbofos, you guys remember counter 5G? Nasty stuff. It's just about down to zero. BT technology has resulted in it. You take that away, farmers will have to go back to using indiscriminate insecticides. We have to control the bugs. Well, really, you don't have to. Can't you just pick them off? Biotech has had no influence on yields. Really? Well, since the introduction of biotech, you see the yield curve in the United States has steepened. The record of corn this year is 503. Europe's corn yields are more linear and lower, and South America is on an exponential growth curve. Brazilian corn yields have increased 400% with only 43% land, more land coming into production. That is an incredible story. And counter to what you'll see on the internet, the GMO technology in Brazil is not resulting in destruction of the rainforest, it's saving the rainforest. And the reason it's saving the rainforest is because you want to destroy the rainforest, you start putting a plow or a disc to those tropical and subtropical soils, and you watch the erosion happen, and then they have to knock down more trees to get more land to grow more crop. That's not what you read. That's not what you hear. This is Roberto Peretti, just outside of Rosario in Argentina. Roberto and his neighbors are the first generations of farmers to leave more earth on this earth than they started with this earth. Their soil is better. Their organic matter is better. Their water holding capacity is better. This hasn't seen a plow or a disc in 40 years. I met Howard Buffett when I was there, and Howard Buffett was absolutely blown away by the adoption curve of no-till by the Argentine farmers since the introduction of GMO technology. You want to talk sustainability? I think everybody agrees that the thin skin, the epidermis of the earth called the topsoil, is our most precious resource. We are not destroying that resource. And a farmer in this room wants to destroy that resource. We soil test, we do precision applications, and we're growing our organic matter, not declining it, if we're doing the right job. Are some farmers? Yeah, some farmers might. Will agriculture lose significant science to non-science? Well, you got people like Chipotle out there who's actively campaigning against GMOs. They're putting the fear of God in the consumer about GMOs. Not necessarily telling them that the cheese is GMO or anything, but, you know, just doing it. They're doing movies called Farmed and Dangerous. Hollywood-style movies. but cows eating Petra pellets and blowing up. Or their scarecrow campaign, freaking awesome campaign. 14 million plus downloads by school children who believe that this is the way you raise your cattle. This is what's being shown to school children today. The latest one on the livestock side is Cowspiracy. There's a whole bunch of them coming down the pipe. I want you to watch this. Tell me what you think.
Genetically engineered crops in agriculture, a worldwide experiment on people, animals, and nature. Cultivation of genetically engineered crops like soy, maize, cotton, or canola have far-reaching consequences. 90% of genetically engineered crops belong to the corporate agricultural group Monsanto. The rest are owned by Syngenta, DuPont, Bayer, and others. Genetic manipulation of crops can have uncontrollable consequences. The function of genomes is only partially understood, but foreign genes are still introduced into crops. These genetically engineered crops are widely cultivated outdoors where they cannot be controlled. Currently, 90% of GE cultivation occurs in the Americas, particularly in the USA, Argentina, Brazil, and Canada. It seems researchers have forgotten that genetically engineered crops once outside can no longer be controlled like they could in the lab. GE crops can self-replicate and pass on their new characteristics to neighboring crops, penetrating the fields of farmers who want to cultivate their crops without genetic engineering. Adverts from the genetic engineering lobby claim genetically engineered crops produce higher yields, but this marketing mantra is a complete hoax. It has been shown that crop yields for GE crops are no higher than normal crops, but farmers must buy more expensive patented genetically engineered seeds each year. This forces them to become dependent on corporate giants. But that's not all. Genetic engineering giants also produce pesticides and herbicides. There are two characteristic traits of genetically engineered crops. They are either resistant to herbicides, in which case the genetic engineering company itself produces the suitable herbicide, or the genetically engineered crop emits an insecticide. Whether or not the crops are resistant to weed killer or give off poisonous gases, not only weeds or pests are eliminated, other beneficial field growth and some living creatures are killed as well. But nature adapts, so pests and weeds develop resistance to pesticides. And that means that increasing amounts of stronger pesticides will be used. Especially grave consequences are observed in this respect in monocultures. For example, in South America, rainforests and other natural landscapes are destroyed every day to make room for genetically engineered monocultures and pasture. At the same time, the soil and groundwater are poisoned. On top of that, the genetic engineering lobby claims genetically engineered crops can help to reduce world hunger. Genetic engineering is not the answer. There is enough food on Earth. The problem is that it's not distributed fairly. But the fact is that most genetically engineered crops find their way into the livestock chain. So they end up as meat or dairy products in supermarkets. Along with all the destructive effects on the environment, one last awkward question remains. How do genetically engineered crops affect humans and animals? The answer is, no one knows. Therefore, it's important for you to carefully consider which products you buy. Get informed and get involved, because our world is not a testing ground. For more information about genetic engineering, go to greenpeace.org/GMO.
Had I shown you that video before I just did my talk, a lot of you and the people would applaud and buy right into that. I could rip that video apart sentence by sentence, word by word. If it's not a distortion, it's a lie. And that's what most people are being fed around the world. There's big money in selling fear. Danny Glover now is appearing in the latest show. This is called Consumed, and this is a thriller and a horror. It's all fictional, but it's an anti-GMO movement. Of course, he's got his Prairie Organic Farms hat on in his quintessential bib overalls, of course. So what are we going to do about it? What are we going to do about it? Well, at the Red Deer Chamber of Commerce, a bunch of farmers sit on a panel called the Agriculture Policy Committee, and we put forth a resolution called Support Biotech and Agriculture that went through the Red Deer Chamber of Commerce and through the Alberta Chamber of Commerce, and on the 27th of October was passed by the Canadian Chamber of Commerce with a 90% vote, and it will hit Justin Trudeau's desk. So that's something we can do. Need to do more of that. Question is, what am I going to do about it? That morning, after the Chilliwack concert, I was still shaken. I called my son up, Nick Saik, and I said, Nick, I want to make a movie. He's a filmmaker. Nick's 27 and pretty talented filmmaker. And I said, Nick, I want to make a movie called No GMO. He says, no GMO? I said, nah, no GMO. We have to contain, we have to turn the conversation from no to no to understanding. And so we went out last year and I stroked the check for 10 grand and then Agri-Trend stroked the check for 10 grand. And then I called up Kevin Blair, his wife's in the audience, and Kevin stroked the check for 10 grand. And I called up six buddies. We raised $80,000. We launched this last year at the Farm Forum event, raised another $50,000 that night from farmers. And since then, we've been raising money from farmers. Alberta canola producers have stuck in 150. Saskatchewan growers, I think 200,000. We've raised about $800,000 to produce this movie. No GMO is a major world-scale movie project. It's a documentary, full-featured, world-class documentary with vignettes that are going to be produced for Ag in the Classroom, so we can talk about biotechnology in the classroom. The concept is to neutralize, educate, and advocate on behalf of agriculture. And I already told you that we're $400,000 short right now. And because Minister Ritz is no longer the Minister of Agriculture, I'm out of contacts and I need some help. So we've got to raise some more money to get the movie finished. Everybody gets a tax-deductible receipt through Farm and Food Care Foundation, which operates here in Saskatchewan, with a tentative release 2016. We filmed in Canada, the United States, Argentina, Brazil, Uganda, Kenya. Nick just got back yesterday from LA where he was filming Peter Diamandis, who's chosen to be on the movie. So we wanted support for the movie, and this is what it looks like. Hi, my name is Rob Saik, and I'm a professional agriculturalist who works with farmers. I work with all kinds of farmers. I work with conventional farmers, I work with high-tech farmers, I even work with organic farmers and all kinds of crops, from corn to canola to cotton. The project that I'm here to talk to you today about is No GMO, the documentary. It's a project designed to bring attention and information to urbanites and school children about what's really going on in agriculture. GMO technology has been a benefit to people all across the world. What we have here is a crop of canola. This is a GMO crop, and this produces one of the most healthy oils on the planet today for human consumption. This crop is grown with a GMO technology that allows farmers to significantly reduce tillage and reduce the amount of pesticide they're using to grow this crop. The fact of the matter is the total pesticide load on the land and in the crop is dramatically lower because of GMO technology. However, this is not what you would see if you Googled or researched GMO technology on the internet. It's my contention that the non-science movement is the largest threat to agriculture today in terms of our ability to feed the planet. Golden rice, which has been ready for commercialization since 2002, that is fortified with beta carotene that can provide vitamin A to prevent millions of people from going blind, and has yet been sitting on the shelf while activists fight against its commercialization. This film is designed to attack the memes that attack GMO, and we need your help to raise the funds necessary to take this message forward to film the full documentary, which will be global in nature. Thanks for listening to this, and thanks for participating in No GMO, the movie project. Notice the graphics here, like this is high end. And Nick said to me, he said, Dad, it's not gonna work with your style. You are too abrasive. He says, it's gonna work by showing both sides of the discussion and bringing people together. This is the tone of the movie. I'm sorry that the audio isn't louder. We just couldn't get it to go any louder for you. But this is the trailer, and then I'm going to show you a couple of snippets of our raw footage that we just taken.
Is something bad happening when you eat an apple? Because we changed it to taste better.
In 1943, Abraham Maslow defined human motivation as a hierarchy of needs.
And supporting everything we do is food. We have a long track record of adapting it, modifying it, to better suit our needs. We made carrots orange. That doesn't make them wrong. Broccoli, cauliflower, Brussels sprouts all come from one plant. That's not unnatural. And with so many people counting on a better solution to hunger, isn't every idea worth knowing? Let's stop shouting, start listening, and find out what it really takes to feed us. All of us. No GMO. An uplifting discussion about food.
So that's the tone. Far different than my tone. Nick's tone. He probably voted for Trudeau too. Just saying. This is Dr. Gonzalez. Dr. Gonzalez was the breeder that bred the rainbow papaya that saved the papaya industry. And he's soft-spoken, so this is a chunk of what we picked up in Hawaii. And by the way, if you're vacationing in Hawaii this year, particularly Maui, it is ground zero of the GMO fight on the planet, as far as I can tell. Bylaws have been passed and counter-bylaws, and it's a violent fight. It's abrasive. As a farmer there, you don't want to be wearing your Cargill or your Nixera hat or whatever, because people just come unglued. Anyway, here's the story.
In the middle 80s, when biotechnology was a king, they'd have meetings say, you know, in 10 years, we're gonna have all these different crops, tomatoes, blah, 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 all of this thing, commercialized virus resistance. So
what happened?
Well, that's my question.
Right now, we're living in a society when you have a huge disconnection between the farming and the general public.
Life now is changing, and Maui is the ground zero.
We are going through these different phases, and right now in agriculture, in our life, we think that anything that is natural, it's supposed to be good for us.
It is going to be very difficult to change this trend.
So do you feed your kids GMO food?
I do, all the time, and on purpose.
We're looking at what we're doing today as a commodity. And the reality is, we're producing food. How do we have a discussion and dialogue about producing food?
Hundreds of people want to talk to me, but they never listen. That's life, eh?
It's really great. I mean, it's really great. Hundreds of people want to talk to me, but nobody ever listens. And he was such a modest man, such a wonderful interview. This is a great interview, too. This guy on the screen, as near as I can tell, well, his name is Blue Mountain. The guy's name is Blue Mountain. And Blue Mountain, he runs kind of a organic farm community in Hawaii. And I'm not sure if it's Maui or the main island. I wasn't there filming. I was raising cash while my son Nick was in Hawaii filming. There's something wrong with the project. Anyway, as far as I can tell, the guy was actually born in Connecticut to a fairly wealthy family and moved to Hawaii and there. So what you're going to hear here on this clip is you're going to hear his impression of the papaya problem under his understanding. And the second guy you're going to see in the screen is really, if you're a farmer in the crowd, is really you. The second guy is a Hawaiian farmer. He actually is from Hawaii. He's a Hawaiian farmer growing papayas in Hawaii. So you're going to see the contrast in the discussion. So here we go.
The
GM farmer in Pune, but if you were looking at it like a GM papaya farmer's operation in Hawaii, what other choice could those producers there have made to avoid the GM? Like, if you lose your farm to a virus, I'm just wondering, like, what do you think, what's the solution?
Well, I'm questioning even the data. From what I understand, it was not this panacea that the genetic, biotech industry wants to make it out to be.
I got wiped out. I was cutting trees every week. I had like about 7-8 acres of papaya trees here. Every week I would be cutting down trees. And it was just too much. So I moved on to the North Shore, find new land, virgin land again to escape the disease. But within 5 years, the same situation. So the disease was just spreading. The pressure, virus pressure was too much. And so it got to the point where Oahu was just wiped out. And we just about gave up all the papayas on Oahu.
So it's a whole balance. I would rather have some loss to pests than to introduce chemicals and pesticides, fungicides that we don't really know how they accumulate either in the soil here or what they do when they get washed into the streams. And
there's nothing certain in the world. You know, whenever I give a talk, I always ask them, how many of you have one of these in your hands? You know, everyone goes, this never has been tested. This just came out, 10 years ago? How much radio waves is affecting your brains, you know? And so I always tell that to young people. I say, well, are you going to reject it? No.
I mean, this is interesting. I just noticed, I'm a movie maker, so I watch a lot of film, watch a lot of TV, and I noticed that when it comes to food and telling people about food, the number one device used is fear, it seems like to me. It's hard for me to think of a documentary about food that is not based around scaring the people who are watching it, you know? And I'm wondering, what do you make of that?
Well, I'd like to see it be more of a celebration of the diversity of plants and medicinal plants and food plants that are available in this world. I mean, we're lucky enough to live in a semi-tropical climate where we can grow pretty much anything. You know, all of the tropical fruits from South America and so on can be grown here. So we do have that food selection. I think it's a wonder when you go down the vegetable aisle and there's so many different colors and shapes and textures.
Hawaii is very vulnerable. Almost 80-90% of our food comes in from the mainland, you know, or from someplace else. And so we're desperately trying to maintain our local supply. But yet, if you keep nicking away from these guys, who's going to produce it? Go to the open market. You see a lot of local fruits, a lot of local vegetables. And you cut their legs off, you're not going to have that.
So it's interesting. One guy says that there's great diversity, great biodiversity. They can grow anything they want in Hawaii. And then the other guy says that 90% of the food is imported into the islands. So who's right? Interesting, right? All right. Last one is from Africa. And if you've ever traveled to Africa and you spent time in banana groves, you'll see the devastation of bacterial wilt and black sigatoga. Again, there is no cure. There is no thing you can do. They spray with insecticides all the time. It doesn't do anything. And what you're going to see here, and it's hard to hear these guys a little bit, but what you're going to see with your eyes is you're going to see the pus that comes out of the plants that are infected. And if that pus hits a healthy plant, the healthy plant is infected. It's bacterial infection. And then you're going to see the folks filming a marketplace where the women that are selling the bananas are asking for a cure, and then they'll wind up with Nick's thoughts.
Soon, we shall forget the banana plants and even cassava plants if we don't adopt the new sciences, modern science.
So this tree, we're saying, had 6 months or so to get to the point where it can produce fruit, right?
It is 9 months to bring to produce.
Right.
To become, to show signs of getting a bunch.
So the two things that are striking about that from a North American perspective are that a plant can get this big in 9 months.
Under proper management.
Yeah, under proper management.
Yes.
And then B, look at the sheer mass of destruction here, right? This isn't a little plant. This is tons and tons of the plant being destroyed by a bacteria. This is sickness, and this plant needs a vaccination, or we need a plant that is resistant to this. This needs a solution. We have the power to do it.
The scientists have the powers.
Yeah. How much was this tree worth? How much value did we lose by cutting this down?
Now, when we talk of one bunch,
yeah,
we are forgetting the suckers.
Right.
We are forgetting the mulching material.
There's all this value here that is now just lost.
A minimum of 200,000 syringes, Uganda syringes, lost.
Oh.
Lost. This just one stem.
When it is diseased, the yellowish fluid comes out of this.
Right.
They cut
right
at this mainstream, and then they observe yellowish, and that one.
That's no good.
It's not good.
No good.
She's asking.
Yeah. We're trying. We're trying to get a solution here. We're trying to tell people who don't know about it, so that we can do something about it.
It seemed to me that the people were begging for answers for the researchers.
Oh, God. You want to be put in an awkward position. Have somebody at a market ask you for a solution. I don't know if we caught that or not, but there's a point where a lady came up to us in the market, and through Simon, our interpreter, she asked me if I knew of a solution. What am I going to say to that? Yes, but my country is keeping it from you? Awkward. It was an awkward position, and not in a bad way, but just in a way that highlights the real gravity of this situation, right? Is I do have a solution. Unfortunately, me wanting to give it to you isn't enough. I need you to want to give it to her.
You go to Kenya, and they've had GMO bananas that are resistant to black Sigatoka for quite a while. Last year, when I was in Kenya, our driver knew President Museveni. I wrote a letter to President Museveni, a one-pager, encouraging him to embrace biotechnology and agriculture. And just last month, President Museveni came out in favor of biotechnology and said we do need to embrace it to help our people. Now, to wind up, I want to invite you all to an event that we're putting on December 1st, 2nd, and 3rd at TCU Place in Saskatoon. The event is called the Farm Forum event, the 17th year. Our theme this year is the biotech connection, and people like Dr. Kevin Folta, John Entine of the Genetic Literacy Project, Owen Patterson, who's a member of parliament out of London, England, and former environmental minister, will talk about the pressures going on in the EU, the anti-GMO pressures. And so I want you to come out to it if you can. Well, that is my talk. And it's time that we learned. It's time that we studied. Time that we understood. It's time to say not no GMO, but to know GMO. Thank you very much.